재밌어야 되니까 저는 그게 참 상대를 도발하는 거라고 생각하기보다는 그냥 정말 재밌는 경기에서 서로 재밌게 한다라는 그런 표시기 때문에 저는 정말 다시 보고 싶어요.
Welcome back to the Bill Graham Civic Auditorium, where Korea's Rocks Tigers are setting up against newcomers to Worlds, the LCL's Albis Knox Luna. So, Papa Smithy, I turn to you to help us intro today, or this year's favorites, perhaps, in the Rocks Tigers.
I mean, the thing about the Rocks Tigers, you know, everyone knows about them. They know they came second at Worlds last year. But with a lot of these Korean teams, sometimes it feels like kind of the emotional storyline of some of these teams is kind of removed compared to some of the Western teams. But Rocks have kind of laid all the cards on the table. This is the team that famously practiced under very questionable circumstances last year, couldn't run air conditioning, had to practice in PC bunks rather than at the gaming house because of their financial struggles. So many players, they chased the money. You know, that was an option for a lot of these players. Everyone talked about whispers of SMEB, getting a massive offer from China and things like that. They stayed together to win. And man, it took three finals, three losses, fourth time's the charm, finally won LCK. This team is here to win Worlds. And they come in favorites, so they're doing something right.
Very much so, and we do have to make note of Peanut in the jungle, so it's not the exact five that
True.
We saw last year. So small adjustments to the roster, but largely still the same squad. Now on the flip side of it, we do have our opposing team in Albis Knox Luna. So Crumbs, help me out here. What is this squad looking to do against the tournament favorites?
I think they're just looking to last as long as they can. You go in there and you want to learn something out. You want to see whatever thing that you can actually implement for your own future games and trying to play spoiler. I mean, even the likes of CLG and G2 don't really even think about taking games out of Rock. So if Albus Knox can learn something from this and utilize it into their games against G2 and CLG, they might be able to actually play big spoilers in this group.
And honestly, instead of looking at the team, we could look at some of their key players too. They have like Kira in the mid lane, known from All-Stars 1v1 tournament. He won the qualifier to the wildcard All-Stars there. Especially their support, Liquid, too, is so enjoyable to watch sometimes when it's doing well. He is a very binary support. He doesn't really agree to all the norms and boundaries that bot lane has to offer. So sometimes he'll go for a crazy trade, but it works out. The guy is super aggressive. If we can get his hands on some champions that he plays like a brand support.
I want to see this brand.
Definitely a player worth watching here because they can come out with a surprise and do something that we are not used to seeing.
Yeah, I mean, he is 12.9% of his team's damage. The average for supports at Worlds is 7.2%. That's insanity in terms of the amount of damage that's coming from the bot lane, but that half of the bot lane, at least.
And then you're talking about aggression, of course, Dashy pointed out. Peanut coming into this roster for the Rocks Tigers. He's the man that made this team go from a passive early game team to utter aggression. I mean, he kept an enemy jungler buffless for the entire game back in spring season. So that adaptation, if you've only watched Worlds, if you only watched those international events, watch the Rocks Tigers. They're not the same team from Worlds 2015.
I'm excited to see them on their first time on the Rift. It's time now to see these teams hit the Rift. So let's send it over to our casters.
Thank you very much, Dash. We are here to witness game two now of the World Championship here. And this is one that, again, people are expecting to be number one versus number four in the group. But of course, upsets can always happen. We've seen it before. And so let's get ourselves into the game. First up, we're going to talk about the LCK Summer Champions, Rocks Tigers, and put their roster up on the screen here. Their top laner, SMEB, many consider to be the best player in the world. Peanut, their new jungler this year, could be the best in his role as well. Kuro in the mid lane, Frey and Gorilla, the AD carry support, with their coach, Nofei, former player, now coaching.
And on the red side, it's the LCL's number one, Albis Knox Luna. Up top is Smurf. In the jungle, PvP stay host. Mid, Kira. AD carry, a miracle. Support, Lakritz, and coach, Anspa.
So we'll see what can happen with these players. I want to bring up a player that's going to be a whole bunch of fun to watch. We'll probably see him in the ban phase. Lakritz, the support here for Albis Knox Luna. Famously a brand and Zyra main.
A mage support.
I love mage
also, carry support.
He's yes. a mage in real life. He wears yeah. the robe. This mm-hmm. guy goes full in on the mage playstyle and yep. life.
Yeah. I mean, it's really, he's a method actor as far as League of Legends
yes.
players goes.
Yeah.
But it's funny because statistically, of course, he is the highest damage share of any player at Worlds.
And
he's actually
the Worlds.
Sorry, yeah, you're right. My apologies. Of any support player at Worlds. Only second highest, though, as far as players overall is another support over in CIS that actually is a harder carry than him. But, of course, ANX is a stronger
no!
team. And there, of course, is the brand ban. No one should be surprised at all.
I think we saw a quick little reaction for the player cams there.
Don't worry, don't worry.
Away, but yeah, unlucky there.
He has more mages ready for sure. Zyra is one of them. Kama's out of him also removed. I'm sure a Bard is available. There's some mages.
Yeah. In all seriousness though, My favorite comp that I've seen these guys run is their poke comp with the Jhin and Varus, and then the high damage AP support to balance that out. Last time it was Brandt. Zyra is also an option that they could use, you know, to even out that damage profile. But that's where I've seen them have a lot of success, and that's what I really like about them, you know, landing these long-range poke skill shots and having a lot of high damage output.
Yeah, I think it's important to highlight that Albus is not a team that straight up bullies people back in Russia. No, they don't destroy the laning phase specifically. They actually have pretty good understanding of how to play the late game and known as a bit of a macro team in their own region. Problem is, you play against the Rocks Tigers, who obviously are a fantastic macro team in the mid game as well, especially. And they just have this insane early game now with Peanut and, of course, Smep just getting better and better up in the top lane. So if you are, you know, a late game focused team, probably not going to work against the best team or potentially the best team in the world.
Yeah, I mean, any tactic you take against, you know, the team that is a favorite to win the entire tournament is going to be rough, but we'll see what they start out with here. You know, the Bard Jhin, that is a very high damage bottom lane, and maybe we get to see Likrit making some moves around the map.
And both teams really putting pretty heavy priority on making the bottom lanes look pretty strong. Again, Bard, one of Likrit's best champions, but also this Nami Lucian, again, a very strong 2-1-2, one of the more lane dominant combos you can find.
Two games in a row where we see the team on red side go with double bot lane picks in the first rotation. CLG last game blocked in Kate with Nami for one of the absolute strongest 2v2s you could possibly get. Here we see more focus on comfort, obviously with the Bard, of course, for Likrit, and then that Jhin you talked about, Kobe, the long range poke they like to play. Jace is still available if they want to have that as a potential last pick.
Ooh.
This is a little bit of a surprise. Didn't expect to see a whole lot of Shen anymore. He does struggle against a lot of picks after like one item up in the top lane. I think like Gnar, Kennen, some of these different champions. Rumble as well is actually really good against Shen.
Especially blind picking a Shen versus Smed. You know, they talked about before, but widely considered, you know, now maybe the best player in the world overall. And hovering over the Rumble already, looking like he wants to punish. He does have an Elise at his back, so that could very that could help a lot because Peanut spends a lot of time up on the top side of the map.
But if you are Smurf here in this game, you might say, you know what, I'm not going to beat this guy 1v1, so give me a champion where I can then leave the lane like Dashaun did in the last game on Puffy and just go down to the bottom lane. So I think the strategy here is don't try and just destroy the top lane because the 2v2 of Peanut and Smeb is the strongest in the world. It is so, so hard to do anything against these two guys. So if you just pick a champion that can go to the other side of the map, you can actually play very aggressive now around the bottom lane. Nami is a super squishy support with zero dashes or anything. That's a bot ulti at level 6, and then she dies.
Always a possibility we see how well the assassinations can work. The profiles of champions coming out here. Two physical damage marksmen of sorts for Rocks Tigers, and of course, two high damage magic damers in the Elise and the Rumble here. But a lot of long range tools. You mentioned poke before. Jason Rumble, honestly, can hit you again from sort of off the screen. And Lucian, not too shabby with the culling either, so we can see a lot of long range pressure. And the final pick going to come through for Albus Noctuna will be the Vladimir in the mid lane for Kira. Thinks it'll work well up against the Jace in the mid.
Yeah, I don't really agree with him on the Vladimir pick against Jace. I think this is actually super risky. Vlad is a champion who really wants to build early magic resistance. Like, the greatest thing is to get a Spirit Visage, and then you can survive versus like most of the mages. Well, Jace doesn't really care about your MR. If you build early
MR, really?
he's gonna wreck you completely with this Ghostblade builder. We get to see Jace mid lane, expected more top, but in this game here...
You are actually forced into building early armor versus Jace right now, or you'll far way too far behind. You can get to true damage pretty much with the most popular flat armor penetration builds right now. But again, you talked about playing for the team, and maybe it's more of a team pick here for Kira. Kira actually, he does have some of the highest CS difference numbers. However, he has some of the lowest kills plus assist numbers of anyone at the entire tournament there for a mid laner. So focus on trying to farm, and we'll see if they can make something happen in team play.
Yep, farm lane probably all Kira wants, and maybe you can see Shen and Graves band together to get some decent damage on Rumble. He's one of the more gankable champions. You expect that to be a pushing lane for Smeb, so maybe it does shove in and Graves gets behind him.
Also, I just have to always reiterate this cautionary tale of ganking Rumbles, though. Yes, he does push automatically, and it's a good champion to gank really early on, but be very careful when he's level 6 or post-level 6, because Smeb is definitely a guy that might get double kills in that.
Well, let's see what happens to get ourselves into the this game. Vote for who you think's going to win this one. Hashtag ROXWin, hashtag ANXWin for which squad you think's going to come out victorious here. Tournament favorites, Rocks Tigers, their first game of the World Championship as we load ourselves onto the Rift here in San Francisco. And let's see who's going to join CLG at 1-0 to top the group.
I like how you had to squeeze that in.
Just saying.
Of course. It is
I always bring up the storylines. You guys are the smart players who talk about the champions and how well they play in the comps. I'm going to talk about the players and how they're doing.
Let's talk about these icons they're spamming now because, you know, CLG, boom, all at the same time. Very coordinated there at the end of the game. But Rocks already sewing a little bit of...
There's a worrying trend for sure early on. We only day one now. Game two, obviously. The tournament favorites, as you said, Freak, against Alba CR team. We don't really expect to see do a whole lot against the Rocks Tigers, but it's when you don't expect it, you know, there could be some crazy things happening in the early game. There are four members down the bottom lane sending in support on some crazy mission, trying to see, you know, can he maybe bait Gorilla to take a trade? Will they try and hit him? Because the rest of the members were actually hiding behind Liquid here. They didn't show early on. No one decided to overstep, though, on the side of Rocks Tigers.
So not too much aggressive so far. We do have a Krugs ward in from Rocks Tigers on the top side, so they can probably track where the Albus Nox jungler does start. No similar deep wards, though, from Albus Nox, so it actually is a early game advantage vision-wise for the Koreans here of Rocks Tigers. And those small advantages can mean quite a lot when you are able to figure out what your opponents are doing early on in the game.
And we're going to see this a lot in this meta here, where level one teams are like grouping a little bit and maybe hinting towards a quick invade, but very rarely do we see like big, massive invades just all the way in, because you don't have to anymore when lane swaps is not a thing. Back in the past, you would invade, get deep vision, spot a lane swap, and then either, you know, take the lane swap or take the standard lanes. Now you just kind of hover around river most of the time and try and set up a little trap maybe, and then you play around these early camps instead.
Yeah, the early camps there, you can see Albus Nox don't even try and take it because they see the Tigers coming in on their defensive ward, but also just that small amount of information, know where the enemy jungler is for sure starting, does help tremendously. And Peanut on this Elise is very capable of making early moves.
Final shot goes onto the minion. So far, so good. No missed CS for Albus Nox, but actually Prey missed too. You don't expect to have huge nerves, but sometimes it happens, and he's been away for the World Championship. And right now, though, we still expect to see Rocks Tigers be a bit dominant. Peanut clears two camps on the top side. Gromped into blue buff, now heading down for the early red. Make sure he's not getting anything stolen from him.
Yeah, it's still very standard to see junglers always aim to have that red buff within like the first three camps they do. Because then you get level three and you can look to either contest river for Rift Scuttler, or you can look for an early gank if you want to. And it's important you're ready to react in case the enemy jungler is already on the map doing something.
Definitely true. And Gray's one of the best at staying high health in the jungle, so he's always ready to react to any situation. The thing there, he did kind of intelligently, though. They saw the mid lane was pushing up Kuro on the Jace. It was trying to push Kira in, and so he pulls the blue buff back into the brush, even though there's a ward that goes down, completely safe, no threat of invading. They do spot out where he is, though, so Peanut takes that information, goes for the first camp steal of the game.
Exactly, really smart play. Kuro shoves up, as you mentioned, puts the ward down. Now they can track PvP Stejos, who comes in late to the fight, but still, Peanut's not liking this battle. Look at the damage output. He's almost dead. This
can
actually be first blood. Exhaust comes in, suddenly Kuro's here, and Smeb has already rotated down as well. Smurf's got to show up soon. The flash to get away. Peanut still gets control over the Raptors, and I think Rox actually came out ahead here.
Well, yeah, Smurf. Feb is the...
This is the taunt, goes back for the trade again. Stejos looking for him, more damage, and he might bring him down. Smurf flashes, gets away from the buckshot. But here comes Peanut over the wall, looking to find the sun, gets it now. The taunt's not going to mean much, and gets himself first blood, and here's the chase! Jumps over the wall, good rappel. The taunt's going to land into Kuro, though. How much more do they have?
He's down!
The last little bit in, and it's two kills for Albus Nox!
Talk about being ready to react to any situation. You can track PvP Stejos on Graves, but Elise at half health cannot take that fight, and Peanut got blasted there. Oh my goodness, two kills starting it out here for Albus Nox Luna.
Such a greedy invade here from the Rocks Tigers, and Peanut walking in, and then he just finds a Graves in his own jungle, able to proc that Q on the wall very quickly, win that early trade. Smurf came down very late, but once he finally joined,
He made some magic.
If we track the damage dealt in this exchange, like PvP Stayhos does so much here, even though the first roam is from Smeb. That's kind of why Peanut turned around for a second there, is because he knew he had Smeb on the way. But it's a disjointed three-man move here for the Tigers. Kuro is out of mana on this Jace, so they know they've got him trapped in the jungle.
And they know Smeb is coming from somewhere, but not really sure where exactly to find him on topside. Now Smeb just simply caught out, has to flash away, but you're behind enemy lines now. Three members in the jungle, and now you die.
Yep. Smurf gets enough damage in, and Stayhos knows he can chase him out. Yeah, I guess he's gonna live, and the Elise gets to walk away, but another great taunt comes out from Smurf, and just means enough CC is there.
Yep, good maneuvering there by Smurf also to get that Q pass through for the extra slow, just to make sure nobody's gonna get away, and let's see how they can snowball the
portal. Looking for the gank, can they find much? Stayhos gets away from the bubble. Bit of a slow on the Gorilla, will not land the roof though. Miracle's gonna miss that shot. Bit of damage coming through. Ignite is on. Prey running out of HP. Last shot's a crit. He's got a flash early. That could have been a kill if Miracle landed it. But here comes Rox. Yep. Coming down. Good bubble on a Licorice. He's not in a good spot at all. Here comes the Repel trying to join in, but he's not gonna land the Cocoon. Peanut's not gonna get it. Oh. Chase into the turret. Kuro, the turret shot. It's gonna be a trade kill. One for one for the roam.
Kira needs to push mid lane now because he was left there and he started to roam really, really late. He needs to shove that minion wave in, try and punish Rox for that roam. And it was very good. They were able to get that counter kill there. Rox, definitely a little bit of a fumble here in the early game.
But they're so aggressive as well. Like you see Kuro just leaving the mid lane instantly as a fight start on the bottom lane here. They could have just backed away and said, everyone is alive. You know, a few summoners were used and that's it. But no, they went for that dive here. It's a good setup, honestly, here. I like this from Albus Nox. They're trying to force a flash out of Gorilla. They see Prey's taking the trade, so they go for him. He's forced to flash away. And now, once you see Licorice flash here, you can just turn around, go back to your lanes, and you're going to be fine.
Watch Licorice land his Q from the bush. Oh, there's someone in the bush, actually, there. Gorilla had vision, but he does land it. That makes Kuro go really deep into the turret, and they trade the one for one.
Yeah, let's remember that Kuro was just sitting mid lane. Smurf taking some damage. Again, it's not really the funniest lane to play Shannon. Not hard to trade with the Rumble, but here's his jungler.
Taunt's not gonna be it for now, but he's gonna ult again. He's a range. They really want to pick off Smeb. The taunt's gonna get in a second. Not quite into the turret just yet. A Miracle gonna get stunned up, and look at all the damage output. There's no chance to turn it around off the smallest of windows with Licorice. Just not in range. A great dive and a great kill for Rox Tigers.
Yeah, here we gotta question the decision to go top lane and gank. Rumble was full HP. Shen was not really able to do a whole lot. Barely has any damage at this point with the early AMR, and then you see a gank in the bottom lane from Peanut versus the no flash Jhin. It's a good choice here from Peanut, picking the right lane.
Yeah, I actually think that top lane move was really, really forced. They use one of the biggest tools they have in the early game, is that first Shen ultimate. No standing knight to be able to turn the map around on the other side, and yeah. Smeb was able to get out without burning any summoners. So definitely a good job by Smeb avoiding that, but a bit of a force on the top side.
Absolutely. Licorice now in a bad spot, but a nice magical journey away. You talked earlier during Champ Select about how difficult it is to dive onto Rumble with the ulti. He had used it in a trade against Smurf. They thought, this is our opportunity. Maybe we can dive him now with the ulti down. Of course, it did not work, and sadly, Stain Meta was not able to be used to save their bot lane as Miracle got dived not long ago.
I remember Rumble is a bit of a bruiser, also with the Doran shield early. It's hard to take down some of these tanks. A lot of damage here from Kuro onto Kira.
Opening in, not a lot of CC left though as Kuro is running away. Ghost is on. Kira gets some decent damage, puts the pool down for a slow, and that means Graves is in range. Kuro does not have the ability to get out, and that is a kill for PvP Stayhos. Albus Nox keeping it up 4-2 in kills.
Stayhos is kind of on fire in this game after the first jungle invade. He is also the shot caller for the team. So this bodes well for them as he starts to head bottom lane. Bardo doesn't land, but they land
a stun on the Gorilla into the root, into the damage output, and the crit gets the kill. Out they go through the magical journey. Prey actually forcing them out 1v3, but still, Albus Nox finding the kills.
Yeah, I like to see it as a jungler who's just ganking every single lane, and the Tigers actually saw him leave the mid lane, and then Gorilla still stayed around the river without flash.
Not respecting the crit's bar. Definitely
the zoning ulti from the bard, of course, into the Q stun near the wall. Smurf, he's taking a lot of damage again.
Wow, walking still. The Equalizer never getting off the carpet, but he will at least survive the encounter. Teleport is going to be up very shortly. He should be able to survive at all. 800 gold lead for Albus Nox. And as I trail off, I want to leave with one final point. Rox is actually here behind half the time at 10 minutes anyway, playing domestically. This actually isn't outlandish rocks to be behind, just generally speaking, watch them play League.
And then normally between 10 and 20 minutes, they go completely crazy, obviously, yeah. and start getting these massive goal leads. They are very, very good at setting up potential tower dives, so pressure points and side lanes, and then you get down an early tower and you take a few kills with it, or you force the enemy back and they can't defend at all. You take those few towers, you get a few more kills, and you always snowball that into more objectives if you are the Rocks Tigers, and it becomes very, very hard then if you start falling behind around that 20-minute mark against them. But right now, they are slightly behind, 700 gold, 700-800 gold to be 100% correct. And we're gonna see, you know, a team, an Albus team here is just gonna keep trying to go aggressive, you know? You have a jungler who's level 7 now, he can just keep ganking. He's extremely strong at this point.
Also, in the game.
Stan United is back up, so they can definitely make a move on the bottom side.
Or maybe gank top again and use the same ult on him.
Well, Liquid's got his ultimate up in about 2 seconds here, and that could set it up. They got a kill off it last time. He's had very good accuracy with his bindings as well, so we might see something else.
And you pointed out there, the ulti from Shen before here, Kobe. There's no TP from Smep, so you need to make a play in the bottom lane. If you're Albus, just go all in here. You can even bot ulti the tower and just use that Shen Stan United to force that dive and get the kills on the bottom lane. You can see Peanut, he knows it's gonna happen. He's around.
Here comes the attempt, gets the bounce back onto the wall. Peanut, here's the ulti in from the Shen as well. Jump to the wall, ulti to get him into range and a flash to get out of the taunt. Liquid still wants to chase down, exhaust on the prey, looking for the moment and not gonna get that tempered fate, sadly. Just a quick dodge out. And Rocks Tigers able to slink away pretty easily. Smurf out of his lane, getting
here
killed.
Oh, he ghosted also. That was both summoners. They're going for Peanut.
Looking for the play out of him. He's going to land the top flash. They're going to get the damage with Hemo Plague. And Kira does get himself the kill. Smeb cannot join for 20 more seconds. Looking now for the play. Can they get it? The culling actually not going to land much from Bray. He's clearing the minion wave away. Kira runs out of health and actually gets popped out. And now Kuro's joining the battle as well. Seho still gets the first kill, but trades his life for it. This is going better and better for Rocks Tigers as Bray is chasing down to find some of his own. The quick slow trap's going to get him out of range. Smeb can join.
Oh!
The snipe from Kuro turns it around and ties up the gold.
Remember, that was all 4v5 as well. As the Vizio pointed out ahead of time, Smeb did not have teleport. He's been farming away happily on the top side of the map. And you can tell Albus Nox Luna, they definitely want to create a play there, but a little bit early.
Well, simply for Albus here, they didn't seem to say, okay, what exactly are we doing? They said, we're going to do something on the bottom side. Well, that's correct. Step two is then, okay, let's push in the bottom lane. Let's just ulti that tower as a bard, and then you can get these kills. But they suddenly picked up or started some fights in the middle of the jungle. They were used ultis and flashes very early without actually hitting anyone. Execution is not good enough, even though they had the right idea here. Make a play on the bottom side.
I think the adrenaline there is definitely pumping through their veins. As you saw there, Smurf, unable to get those CS under the turret, even with Shen with the enhanced Q. A little bit of jitters, you know, after you have some excitement in the early game like that, if you take some time to calm down now, because gold is still even.
Sure. But talking about jitters, I want to talk about the fact that Prey, during that fight, said, I'm going to put culling on the minion wave to make sure that the eventual tower dive is deadlier. And in fact, there were two kills because of the turret putting out damage. So nerves of steel for Prey, who made the right call in a tense situation, could have shot out Miracle, didn't kill the minions instead.
And now once again, Liquid has his ulti ready on this bard here. He missed the two ultis he's used so far. Now it's the Tigers with the TP advantage.
Smurf cannot join, a beautiful equalizer, and here come the kills. The kills are just that now, 7-7. And Smeb is still on the chase. Good dodge in the bubble. Stayhouse not going to lose his life just yet, but a 2-0. And that is efficiency. That is a solid, great game.
Quick two kills, but they're not out yet.
They're not, but it's a 5v3. This is still dangerous, but Albus Nox really wants anything here. Seho's going to clear a bit of the wave. Kira getting sniped and doesn't get a chance to pool or anything. Another beautiful kill by Rocks Tigers as Kuro clears the wave, makes Seho's run away.
Now, the big important thing is they could also turn this into the first turret plus the first Drake, as Ocean Drake is ready and awaiting for them.
Yeah, and this is just a problem when you have the TP advantage. You're setting up for a play and you fail the execution, you give over kills to the Rocks Tigers. Well, they will naturally then get a global advantage and they use it instantly. You see the setup here. They did what Albus was supposed to do before, push in the wave first, then move in behind the tower, and then you execute. And don't fight in the middle of nowhere. No, just fight around these turrets here because you know members are staying around to try and pick up the farm. And look how easy it is for the Rocks Tigers to pick up the kill.
A Miracle never got to take an auto there. He took 80% of his life from culling, the rest from Smeb, almost all out of range.
Look at the bubble coming.
Yep.
We're waiting for it to fish.
We're waiting.
For
it. I'm waiting.
Nicely, and then because Kira didn't see it coming. It is not terribly hard to dodge that on reflexes, but Kira lost it in the clutter and chain CC to death.
We talked about how as a Vladimir, you don't want to go early MR against Jay, so you actually just rush the proto build. It's a very aggressive build. It's not really tanky at all, and he can go down very, very quickly. Kira, though, just aiming for a bit more damage and he's all in, which is really the only place he can use that proto build. Right now he's getting some good poke down. Problem is you had your chances. Honestly, you had moments where you could get a bigger lead.
Five members converging mid.
Marksman around the sports as well. Kira's gonna run out of health pretty rapidly. Nice bit of culling damage. Now the equalizer, and it's actually gonna tag Liquid. He's gonna magical journey over the wall. But Albus Nox keep their members alive if injured. Dodge on the shock blast, and now towards the turret goes Rock's Tigers. Down to 2/3 HP on that one, still putting a few more hits in. And another dodge. Just Temperance Fate's not landing the targets. Deficio puts out 3 in a row so far that have missed their mark. Rock's Tigers continue the mid lane seats. Med missing an ultimate, but who cares? Girl can still land all the snipes. Kira going in for the dive, looking for damage on the Peanut. Gonna dodge the Shock Blast as well. Who are they gonna find? A quick taunt in from Smurf. Curl low on HP. A great stun's gonna land, and Kira getting himself the kill. That's 1-0 so far to Albus Nox. They keep the turret alive as well. Nicely played.
Yeah, what a nice engage and great coordination. Chaining that CC onto Koroi. Had a few seconds on this flash here. Couldn't escape. Mid lane.
Oh, another chase in. What? That was over aggressive. Albus Nox chose that fight and they lost their lives for a 1-0. This time to Rock's Tigers. Not going to get stunned. Peanut expected him to juke right, but he did not do so. Low on HP. They've got to be aware of the fact that a dive could happen. Peanut walking up. Lands an auto attack. Wow. Sejo's flash because he was that afraid. And that will be in the turret. 2-0 now in turrets. Rock's Tigers up 4,000 gold.
As we can see there, you know, the turret changes where Peanut's still in tower range, gets off an auto, even though his target is not. Does take target or turret aggro, then he is Elise, so you can repel. No harm, no foul.
And again, we get to see, let's call them nerfs. You know, you see an animation from Elise, you think it's a cocoon, you just flash away instantly. Obviously, Rumble was also showing up, and now Smurf, he's in trouble.
Versus two, reinforcement coming from the right-hand side, but he's only so durable. Gets away from the shock blast, puts the shield right back on, and puts in the dodge zone. Survive it and gets away from the gank. Bit of low HP on all sides. No kills.
If you to defend, Smurf stays alive. Normally when you play Shen.
Oh, the cocoon into the equalizer and all the damage they could possibly need. A flash chase by Peanut gets the kill.
The Fischio confirmed, not time traveler. Not able to predict. Here we go though. Stay hosted.
Play a nice bubble, hits the graves. Not gonna find much more just yet though. The chase in dodges to flash away from the roof, but how much more can the re-engage really do? Liquor's running out of HP. He's gonna go down. Stayhouse gonna be next, and Rock's Tigers continue to win fight after fight. 12-8 the kill score now. Again, between 10 and 20 minutes, they are explosive. You're seeing it once again right here. The chase out of the turret. Kira, 1v1 against Prey, and Prey comes out victorious. 6-0-2 for Rock's Tigers, 80 carry.
Nobody's left around either. Rock's Tigers can push up 2 lanes right now and take down some more turrets. 18 minutes into the game, tier 2s are falling quickly.
Want to see how the Rock's Tigers had to fight for it in the early game, but now they just keep making the correct calls. They win these engages. Another crit coming in from a miracle, but just not enough. And the Tigers have been able to react.
Yeah.
Crazy start, you know, a lot of plays were happening. And then once the failed dive started or happened, Tigers had TP advantage, have been able to set up plays ever since. And just been staying together, honestly, as a group now, and just been winning these early fights.
Not even at 20 minutes yet, and Rock's Tigers went from a 1,000 gold deficit to an 8,000 gold lead over the last 8.5.
Yeah. Do it again. They stick to the stats.
Rock's Tigers are the 10 to 20 minute team. They smash everybody doing this. They've done it in Korea for the entire split. They're looking to do it here at Worlds as well. Albus Nox, the first of the teams they hope to shutter this part of the game. We'll see them battle more, of course, throughout the next couple of weeks. Rock's Tigers, tournament favorites, showing what they're so good at.
Prey especially has got to be feeling pretty good on that Lucian at the moment. 1v1ing the enemy mid laner, he's got 6 kills to his name. He's got that really big power stack on Lucian with the Black Chamber on top of Ghostblade. Now he's got lifesteal too, so you can have, you know, some more longevity in these 1v1s.
He probably feels like a top 5 AD carry in the world.
Ah, does he?
And he does deserve that for sure. Prey definitely one of the absolute best AD carries we have here in the world. And that's the thing with Rock's Tigers, you know, we have so many of these players on these top 20 lists because so many of them are just star players in their role. Koro is going to take down his tower on Smurf.
Use Deadlouse. Nice. Watching. Instantly turn that into a plug for your top 20 list.
Go check it out.
All right. Well, Abbas Nox able to run away. What, do Rocks have, what is it, 4 players in the top 20?
Oh, they do. Yes.
Yeah, they do.
I'm glad you mentioned ranking? That.
Yeah.
I'm glad you mentioned it. Mm-hmm. Sponsored by Kobe.
Get me out of here.
All right. Well, so far, the game is looking according to plan here for Rocks Tigers. We crest the 20-minute mark right here, and they end that with a 9,000 gold lead. That feels pretty good. Up the Drake as well. Now we'll see what's next up for them. They've reset everybody. They've recalled 3 of their members, putting them back on the map now with their new item, Zonia's Hourglass, to go alongside the Leandri's Torment for Smeb. He can dive into the backline and still survive it. And we'll see what the next fight looks like.
Yeah, we need to see Likrit actually hit an ulti here on this board if they want to try and turn anything around, because if he can lock down someone like Koro, you can then suddenly set up a very easy taunt from Smurf, and then you can try and kill some of these squishies here, but Likrit, honestly, has not been hitting the ultis on board. Early game, he had a lot of opportunities against his army with no flash. Sadly, couldn't execute.
Plus, one of the main problems for ANXTRA at the moment has been that the Tigers have been collapsing on fights far quicker. Tigers have 3 to 4 people collapsing almost instantly anytime he sees any sort of action. As you said, that bottom lane dive. As soon as the Bard Magical Journey came out and they saw the Grave, mid lane and jungle instantly traversed down to the bottom side of the map. And it's very hard to catch them, you know, off guard and catch them out of position.
Going over to the Albus Nox jungle. He stay host playing Graves here. And it's just to land the damage amid the spite from Peanut. Still, blue buff is not enough to withstand a 9,000 gold lead push coming in 20 minutes in. Rocks Tigers putting their emphasis on the bot lane. Smeb at the top side, but he has teleports. We can join the squad. 1, 0, and 4, their lane assignments. As they look to push in the bot lane, tier 2, the minion wave is here. A lot of culling damage. Shutter the Graves, pushing him out. There is the 6th straight unanswered turret by Rocks Tigers.
Very easy now for them to play this 1-4 comp with just a top laner sitting alone. You can see Smeb moves from top lane to mid lane. He can then go back to top lane later and keep 2 lanes pushing towards ANX's base here. And then the rest of the Rocks Tigers can just keep hitting these turrets here as a group.
Looking for the Rilla. Gonna land a bit of a stun on a grill. They're looking for it now. Kira into the back line, finding with the can, but wow, Prey is gone like he's already picked off the Bard. Now the dive in the back line, but they've killed off Prey. Smeb pops Zonia's Hourglass, ready kills back and forth. Low HP on all sides, and an overdive by Rocks Tigers. They've lost 3. Now Kuro's in the mix, looking for more with Peanut. Smurf now trying to trade it back. It's only 1 member alive for Albus Nox.
How are you gonna get out?
Did get a bit more. Now Gorilla on the trade. Nice dodge on Cocoon. One more attack will do it. Smurf gets himself the kill. Chased down by Peanut. And it's the last man standing. Rocks' newest player, their jungler, Peanut, looking to knock down an inhibitor.
Peanut wins the game. He's the only one left alive. He's not gonna take the objective though, because Likrit right back up.
I gotta say though, for all the possible situations, 9,000 gold down, 4-5 is not the worst fight Albus Nox could have gotten.
No, definitely not. And, bit of a crazy dive happening here. The fight starts and they just charge straight forward. Gorilla doesn't actually die early, and then Prey is just dashing into the enemy base. Staying around top, we don't want to watch that. We want to see Likrit instead.
Ooh!
Peanut lets Peanut go outplay early. Outplays himself over the wall. He's going to let his opponent get away. Likrit with the magical journey over the wall gets out with his life. It's still a tough road ahead. Nearly 10,000 the gold lead for Rocks Tigers. The question is mostly what tools they going to choose to use to win this game here. This would be a difficult one to lose. Albus Nox could still try to make the comeback happen, but it is increasingly unlikely as time wears on. And Rocks Tigers setting up Baron Nashor right now.
You're predicting Tigers will start Baron.
Great.
Crit fires in the 5-man bot ulti. And then the massive follow-up Graves, Vladimir, insane AoE coming Kira.
Gotta get that Vlad ult right as they get out of the Tempered Fate.
It is kind of crucially important that Rocks Tigers don't have any real tanks. They're playing this Nami support. Peanut is building pretty heavy ability power. He's going towards Rylaze, which is only semi-tanky. Smeb, building as a mage as well. So those chance picks are actually more effective here by Albus Nox because the opponents are squishier.
That's why we're seeing them die when they jump into enemy base. No one can tank the turret. They do chase him off the red buff here with the culling from Prey, and they defend their pink wards as well. You talk about setting up for Baron. They've got full control of the red quadrant of the jungle. And they're just looking to pick somebody up.
Yeah, and while we can see Rocks Tigers, of course, have a little bit of fun, you know, taking some very aggressive fights, diving into the base. We still get to see some of the things that you expect.
Oh, flank here from Smeb.
Looking for the push.
Who's flanking who?
Who he's going to find. And now he's going to get a little bit surrounded. Eclipse comes in looking for a miracle, gets the shuttle, but gets blasted anyway.
There's the kill picked up. No damage coming across. Two for zero. Kira likely to be next up on this one as Mebkite's back. Prey in a battle with Smurf. Just no damage really dealt on either side as the dodge zone drops off. There's the kill onto Smurf. That's going to be four, five kills now picked up for Rox Tigers, the ace in front of the base. Only 24 and a half minutes in, looking to push it down mid.
Can also just take the Baron here, removing that way to come back in the game.
Yeah.
Of course, where you can try and steal the Baron or take a fight around it. They will just secure this one very, very easily. We're only 25 minutes into the game, so at this point, getting the Baron is super, super important.
Yeah, I think if it were 35 minutes, they'd just try to end the game instead. But the recall's fast enough, the respawn, I should say, fast enough by Albus Nox, they'd only get the inhibitor and force the recall. This is kind of more bang for your time, more advantages, and they can push with the Baron later as we watch this replay.
Yeah, Smeb fully confident here, does have the Zhonya, so miracle there. Not really anywhere to go except walk across the line of hot coals, and Smeb just lays out the barbecue. No danger really for any members of Rox at the moment. Prey a little bit, you know, having to kite a little bit, but that's pretty much it.
Well, I like that we get to see just, again, as we said before here, while Rox Tigers obviously feels very confident and can go for some of these aggressive plays, we see some of the things they do well as a team. Obviously, Koro in the mid lane didn't think about winning the lane hard himself. Now, whenever there was a fight in side lanes, as you guys highlighted earlier, he was instantly moving. Like, way before Kira was moving, he was running down. So he just stayed even in CS instead of building up an advantage. Obviously, he died a few times earlier when we had these crazy jungle trades, but you get to see this mid laner who is really, really good at always roaming first and then helping the side lanes, helping the jungler when he invades. And also when we see the Baron setups, like, they're not taking any chances. It's like full vision coverage, don't engage in anything stupid around the jungle when you have to set up for Baron, and then just slowly choke out the enemy and make sure if they have to fight you, well, they're gonna do it without any vision. They're gonna have to face check and then suddenly get caught out like you saw a miracle did before without any flash.
Now 16,000 gold up, wearing a Baron buff. Really questionable Tempered Fate coming in. That means it's an easy push now for Rox Tigers to knock down the top in inhibitor turret, the inhibitor itself as well. Another snipe lands onto a miracle, chunking him down to half HP. Rox is able to roam right back down to the mid lane. Ooh, plenty of damage coming out of Prey. Red buff in tow also, weathering Kira's health bar down a little bit more. Baron buff minions come in now to the mid lane. A nice stun on the Sejos. He's got to get away from this one. Kira to re-engage. Puts the pool. And he's going to deliver Shannon to the back lines. Can they do enough damage though? Is Peanut going to tick down with the Hemo Plague? Staying alive though. No stun on the Prey. And the re-engage still. Prey wants in. Oh. He's going to find one. Dives in for a second. And he just will not take any damage. That's the triple for him. Kuro takes one of the other ones. And now Smurf will fall. It would have been a Penta. But scumbag Kuro steals it away. But that is the ace inside the base. That should be the game for Rox Tigers to start their tournament 1-0. The tournament favorites stomping everyone in front of them, turning it on after 10 minutes and laying waste to Albus Nox. The synchronized emotes ends game one. Congratulations, Rox Tigers, 1-0.
Great to see them turn it on after 10 minutes when we had some good fights in the bottom lane. Sadly for Albus Nox, they could not execute when they had the global advantage, end up losing kills. And then suddenly Rox had the advantage, had the summoner spells, and just forced place after place after place, and were able to outplay the opponent.
That really is where they lost all of their momentum, in that bottom side, trying to get a little bit too much. But Rox Tigers, you know, confident showing here, and moving up to tie CLG, as Freak was questioning earlier.
That's the thing, those are the top two teams right now in the group. Of course, there are many more games to play. Each team will play six matches in the group stage, each other team once, and then a second time next week. And that'll determine who it's going to be. Those six games, tiebreakers, if you need them afterwards, they figure out which two from each group will advance to the quarterfinals, draw their opponents from the other groups. Rox Tigers, looking good.
Yeah, that's a very important thing when we have a group where there's what looks like a clear number one and a clear number four, that it's very important you don't like mess up along the way and you suddenly drop a game you weren't supposed to, because if you are CLG and if you are G2, you're going to face each other again, obviously, and you want to make sure that you beat the teams under you right now. You need to make sure that, you know, if you are playing a team above you, that either, you know, you at least give them a fight, a run for their money, or you don't show too much, because you want to have something for next week when you play against, you know, if we take the G2 CLG example, when you play against each other again for that battle for potentially second place.
I do want to talk about this game though a little bit, because I think it was much, much closer than most people would have predicted. You come into this one, tournament favorite was Wildcard. You expect an absolute stomp, maybe a sub 20 minute win. We've seen those before at tournaments like Worlds. And this was
a very good early game from Albus Nox. Yes, we know Rox Tigers tend to be a bit weaker in the beginning of the game.
Slower.
I mean, but they are frequently behind. And more often than other teams at Worlds, these are all the best teams from their regions, right? To be the best team in your region and yet still lose half your early games is somewhat of a weakness. And the fact that it's still happening here against a team you're 99% of the time supposed to beat says, okay, well, what if CLG gets their early game lead? Do they even win that game? What if G2 gets their early game lead? Do they win that one? And Albus Nox showing, hey, we can outplay Rox Tigers in the first 10. Can they do that against CLG or G2? And I think that's much more likely than we thought coming into the tournament.
I mean, it definitely is true, right? This team, they changed their name from Hard Random, right? They merged organizations, and they've been on the international stage before. Teams like CLG and G2 definitely do have to watch out. Because, as you said, if you lose one of those games that you're not expected to lose, it completely throws everything through the loop.
Yeah, and we saw a strong early game, as you highlighted, Freak. Obviously, a lot of jungle pressure early on. Every single lane suddenly got attacked once or twice. We need to see a member like Lecrit, though, be a little bit more crisp on the Bard. You got to land some of these ultis if you really want to keep snowballing your lead. And that's where it obviously went wrong for them. But we're definitely seeing a good early game. And if they can keep playing that way, if they can keep putting pressure the first 10, 15 minutes, you can surprise teams. Again, we saw it at MSI. We've seen it before. And that's the key thing, I guess. And don't like just give up hope just because you lose the first game. Because you're playing against the Rox Tigers. You know, most teams would have lost this game.
Sure. And coming in, right, ever since we've had wildcard teams at the World Championship since 2013, they've at least won one game. There's at least been 1 to 2 victories every single year since 2013 that these wildcard teams do pull the upset win and get them in. I think we're poised for another one here at some point in this World Championship. But for now, I'm going to toss over to Dash and the desk to get a close look at that game.
Thank you very much, Freak. That's exactly right. We might be poised for a wildcard win further into the tournament. Not the case here against the Rox Tigers, but I have to say. What?
Game one, we already saw.
Oh, please get out of here. All right. Now, Papa Smithy, we have to acknowledge the fact that that was a scary 10 minutes for Korea's number one seed in the tournament.
I mean, when you're a Korean analyst, you come to these international events, you meet analysts from other regions, they always have one thing they talk about. The gap. Is it getting closer? Are the teams ajar now? Is TSM right next to the Korean teams? Or is that gap getting bigger? Is it a chasm? I didn't think this would be the game where we'd have to talk about the gap. But the first 10 minutes, it was disrespectful from the Rox Tigers. Peanut. We talked about the fact 2 best of 5s in his career, never gone on the international stage. They went for a crazy invade, and Albus were good enough to punish them.
Yeah, it all started with him trying to actually 1v1 the Graves with Wraith aggro at the same time. Obviously not going to work out. And then Albus does a wonderful job of collapsing here. And the crazy thing about this part is going to be watching PvP Seos flash over here and actually be so aggressive on this. Really refreshing to see.
Yeah, this guy flashes for sure. He used to be called PvE Seos by the guys at the IWCQ because he has such a passive farm mentality. But he definitely stayed true to his name here, PvP Seos. Super aggro. Even in the enemy jungle at one point was using his ulti to traverse the Krugs wall. Then he realized obviously he was running out of damage. But hey, at least the aggressive thoughts.
Fancy moves.
Right, but here's the thing. 10 minutes into the game, Albus Nox has an 800 gold lead over Korea's Rox Tigers. Then we've got to turn our heads towards this bot lane turret dive. Once again, a botched turret dive here for Albus Nox. It's going to kind of turn the tables and catalyze what is a huge comeback in just 5 minutes for Rox.
This is a good setup, but he's playing on European solo queue where nobody jukes. Because then the half of the damage gets juked. Then he has to use his ultimate to get over the wall. And you're setting up for a dive with no minion wave. And all your ultimates are kind of used already. Like this Bardo ultimate from Liquid was honestly terrible. Because if he saves it for the dive later on, he could make a turret invulnerable. Right now, Vladimir flashes, E on cooldown. I'm like, over ulti down. They're over chasing, using all their cooldowns. They get one pick, nice. But then you gotta bail.
Yeah, not only does this chase actually take forever, but they refuse to acknowledge the fact that Kura can collapse. He's been deciding whether he should join this fight back and forth. He finally joins the fight, and once he gets into the mix, this is going to go all downhill for Albus.
I mean, the scouting report for IWCQ for this team was they love to go for these really aggressive picks. Invade, force a face check. They got something, but then they got so greedy for more that you let a team like the Rox Tigers pick up a few kills. They don't even have five members of the team. This is all with Rumble getting a big CS advantage in the top. And the best teams in the world get that sort of gold, they punish you.
I have to say, though, I'm really enjoying the resurgence of Jace here as a pick. That sexy snipe there at the end, you know, curving the bullet. Angelina Jolie and Wanted right there. Just so much damage comes out of that EQ combo, especially with the new build. makes games definitely more exciting.
And we do have to respect how aggressive Albus Nox decided to play game one in this tournament. You know, had that turret dive worked out, been executed maybe a little bit cleaner, that really could have been enough of a gold lead to maybe give him a handle on this game.
Well, the one criticism that the casters had that I also had about it was the decision to go to the top side once they were snowballing the bottom lane. They tried to go for the rumble, and then Rox obviously responds immediately, and they put all their focus into the bottom lane. They keep punishing over and over, whereas it should have been Albus just going to the bottom side and making those exact same moves happen, because that's how you want to play with the Shen.
I mean, the takeaway point for me, Rox skipped a lot of steps.
Yes.
Very much, you know, at the first, we caught the first invade pin. I didn't put a ward down early. In general, they took a lot of liberties. Look, they're against a team they're heavily expected to beat, but if you look past the team, you can see some of those discrepancies, and they need to address those for some of their other matches in the group.
All right, well, player of the game here is going to pray 13-1-7 on that Lucian. I mean, at one point, we saw him solo diving a Vladimir in the mid lane. That's a very rare thing to be able to say, is that a Lucian successfully dove a Vladimir.
Yeah, and Rox Tigers kind of sometimes get baited into these crazy games. They're like, you're only like fighting. Sometimes you fight with a pig in mud, and you'll find out they enjoy it. And that's the way sometimes these wildcard games go down, is just very scrappy, almost like solo queue. Mm-hmm. But at least Prey kind of kept his cool about himself. He only died once. He was playing at the front line, but he was doing it calculatedly and just playing it very well. Really aware of the boundaries of his champion.
That's the last thing I want to touch on, is again, kind of the progression of the gold lead here. 800 down at 10. 3K up at 15, so that's a huge 5 minutes right there, 3.8K gold swing. But then ending the game 27-36 game time with a 20K gold lead. I mean, to have been down at 10 minutes and then still win a game in 27, that's nuts.
I mean, just 10 to 15, you're talking about negative 800 to 3.5K. That's basically a barren power play they got just from the mistake first from Albus and then being the Rox Tigers, being the aggressive team we know they can be in the mid-game.
Exactly, so showing that the Rox Tigers, if they can get their heads on straight, are still a powerhouse team. Now, though, for a word with Rox Tigers' man in the top lane, we're going to meet up with Shox on stage.
Thank you very much, guys, indeed. Joined here by Smeb of the Rox Tigers after their first victory at the World Championship. But it wasn't easy in the beginning. Smeb, you guys were big favorites in this game. Can you tell me what happened in those early skirmishes?
Smeb 선수, 우선 다소 쉽지 않은 승리를 축하드립니다. 그 락스타이거스 팀은 이번 대회 가장 강력한 우승 후보 팀을 꼽히고 있는데 첫 경기가 나름 좀 되게 아슬했던 것 같습니다. 경기에 대해서 말씀해 주세요.
다들 이제 오랜만에 경기하고 이제 그렇게 주목을 많이 받다 보니까 좀 긴장을 많이 한 것 같아요. 그래서 초반에 좀 잔실수들이 많이 나왔는데 그래도 잘 이겨낸 것 같아요.
It's been a long time since we played at an actual stage, and since we had so much hype for our team, I think that's why we were so nervous, and that led to some small mistakes in the early game. But overall, I think we were able to shake those off and play our game to win, to close the game.
And that worked. You mentioned it yourself. A lot of hype, a lot different story from last year, where you guys were the number two behind SKT. This year, your first LCK championship, and everybody thinks that you're the undisputed number one coming out of Korea. How different are your expectations for this world championship?
그 이제 팬들의 기대감에 대해서 말씀 주셨는데 작년에는 아무래도 이제 쿠타이거스 팀 그 당시에는 이제 2인자의 느낌이 강했습니다. 근데 올해는 LCK를 우승하고 이제 LCK 1시드로 이제 진출하면서 가장 이제 그냥 그 더할 나위 없는 그냥 1위 팀을 꼽히고 있는데 그렇게 됨으로써 팀으로서 이제 가지는 기대감이 다를 것 같습니다. 그거에 대해서 말씀해 주세요.
일단 SKT 상대로 많이 이제 안 좋았었는데 이번에 썸머 시즌에서는 SKT가 아닌 KT를 만나서 우승을 했거든요. 그래서 아직 SKT는 넘어야 될 선이라고 생각하고 이렇게 많은 분들이 기대해 주시는 만큼 저희도 이번에 기대를 굉장히 많이 하고 있어서 네. 재밌게 즐겨 보려고 해요. 네.
It's true that we lost to SKT a lot in the past, but for this LCK summer, we beat KT to achieve the number one seed. So I still think SKT is an opponent that we have to overcome. And hype is big, we also have very high expectations among our teams. So we're really trying hard.
Yeah, trying hard. For you personally, Smeb, you're considered the best player in the tournament by a lot of analysts, and that is saying something with Faker also being in this tournament. How big do you feel the pressure is on you personally to do well and possibly take home that cup?
그 많은 이제 전문가랑 분석가들이 스매 선수가 페이커 선수를 포함한 롤드컵 전체 선수 중에서 가장 잘한 선수라고 이제 지금 꼽히고 있는데 그에 따른 부담감이 혹시 따로 있는지 그리고 그 부담감을 이겨내고 저기 보이는 이제 소환사 컵을 이제 집으로 가져갈 수 있는지 말씀해 주세요.
일단 부담감은 당연히 엄청나게 있어요. 근데 이제 그렇게 기대해 주신 만큼 이제 페이커 선수만큼 그렇게 세계 최고의 선수가 될 수 있는 기회라고 생각하고 최대한 즐기면서 그런 부담감을 극복해 나가려고 노력하고 있습니다.
Of course, there's a lot of pressure surrounding me, but I think this is a really good opportunity to become that best player that Faker has achieved. So, yeah, I think this is a very good opportunity for me.
We will see what happens. Finally, Smeb, can you tell me who you think will make it out of this group? I assume that the Rocks Tigers for you will be number one, but who will be number two in advance here?
그 이제 그룹 A에서 어떤 두 팀이 이제 다음 8강 진출할 것 같은지 물론 이제 락스타이거즈 팀이 이제 가장 강력한 팀을 꼽히고 있지만 그 외에 뭐 이제 CLG 팀, G2 팀 그리고 오늘 상대한 ANX 팀도 있는데 어떻게 전망하시나요?
일단 여기 오기 전에는 이제 G2 팀을 굉장히 견제를 많이 하고 CLG 팀은 그렇게 크게 잘한다고 생각하지 않았거든요. 근데 오늘 저희 앞 경기에서 CLG가 G2를 이기는 거 보고 이번 조별 예선을 진짜 굉장히 잘해야겠구나. 이게 어려울 것 같구나라는 생각을 했어요.
Before we came here, actually, we were much more worried about G2, and we didn't think that CLG would be this good until we watched their game today. And looking at them play, we think the group will be much more difficult than we expected to be.
Yeah, that is clear. Well, you guys, fantastic first victory. Thank you very much, Smeb, and thank you very much, Homin, for assisting with the translation. Two games down here at the World Championship. We are going to take a quick break, but when we come back, it is H2K versus AHQ. Don't go anywhere.
We load ourselves onto the Rift here in San Francisco. Let's see who's going to join CLG at 1-0 atop the group.
Jumps over the wall, good rappel. The taunt's gonna land in the Kuro though. How much more do they have?
He's
trying
down.
To put the last little bit in, and it's two kills for Elvis Knox.
Talk about being ready to react to any situation.
Мы рамбу уже ТП.
Выйти, выйти, выйти.
Я не уверен, есть ли у него ульта.
Мы ушли.
The quick slow trap's gonna get him out of range. Rev can join.
Oh!
The Cypher Kuro turns it around.
Now the dive in the back line, but they've killed off Ray Smith. Top Zonya's Hourglass pretty kills back and forth. Low HP on all sides and an overdive by Rocks Tigers. They've lost three. Now Kuro's in the mix, looking for more with Peanut. Smurf now trying to trade it back.
It's only one member alive for Albus Knox.
Gunther comes in looking for a miracle, gets the shot ultimate, gets blasted anyway. There's the kill picked up. No damage coming across. Two for zero. Kira likely to be next up on this one as Smeb kites back. Prey in a battle with Smurf. Just no damage really dealt on either side as the dodge zone drops off. There's the kill onto Smurf. That's going to be four, five kills now picked up for Rocks Tigers. The ace in front of the base.
Dare to be different. Revel.